Bush 41, the fellow, then President Bill Clinton, who set this the Bilderberg to the 1991 meeting in Baden-Baden, Germany, he signed the treaty and was ready to send it to the Senate for ratification until a test vote in the Senate gave out 95-0 in opposition to the Law of the Sea Treaty. So he pulled it back, knowing that obviously it would be defeated if he submitted for ratification. Now, Bush is going to submit the treaty to ratification. Some of his aides are saying, well, he's already asked Senate Foreign Affairs Committee, his close advisors, high officials, quietly asked the Senate Foreign Affairs Committee to ratify the treaty. Bush will have to come forward at some point and publicly urge the Senate ratification.
How close do you believe we are, Senator, to losing America as we know it?
We stopped it in 2004 only because no one knew what it was. It passed the Senate Foreign Relations Committee 16-0. So it would have been ratified, okay. But we stopped it by having hearings.
Recently, some senators thought they could reform immigration when the American people weren't looking. Fortunately, we found out in time how bad such reforms would be for us and for our country. Now, some senators think they can sneak a treaty past the American people that will have even more serious costs for our country. Ronald Reagan understood these dangers and rejected the Law of the Sea Treaty 25 years ago. Now, it's time to tell your senators to reject it too.
I have some real concerns about the treaty, and almost all of them revolve around the fact that it does have a binding, or has several binding dispute resolution mechanisms. As I read it, they try to choose the arbitrators, and if they can't, somebody else, the king of the law of the sea land, chooses three of the five arbitrators. Isn't that the case?
The glass in the Law of the Sea Convention is neither half, it's not all full and it's not all empty. We tried to be very careful on that. As to the arbitration, what you describe is correct. And there, the appointing authority, if agreement couldn't be reached, would be the Secretary General of the United Nations.
I think that is a recipe for disaster for us.
This treaty would set up an international tribunal headquartered in Hamburg, which would resolve disputes and be superior to our own Supreme Court. It would be anti-American, like these other tribunals, such as the World Trade Organization. Unfortunately, the Bush administration is using the United States Navy to lobby for this treaty. Now, don't pay any attention to what they say. You know we have civilian control of the military. There's no way the Navy can oppose a Bush policy. They're trying to tell us that they need this treaty to do what the Navy has to do. This is an insult. Our American Navy can go anywhere we want on the high seas, and we don't need to ask some international authority.
And there is a separate Article 213, which is entitled Enforcement with Respect to Pollution from Land-Based Sources. If everything about land-based pollution is purely feel-good, hortatory, why would there be an article entitled Enforcement with Respect to Pollution from Land-Based Sources?
Many of the pollution provisions of the treaty are what we call framework provisions. It's what I mean when I call the convention a constitution for the oceans.
But again, that it seems odd to put a feel-good provision like that with a title Enforcement with Respect to Pollution from Land-Based Sources, because this treaty does have enforcement mechanisms. And I just have one article here. It's titled Potential Causes of Action for Climate Change Damages in International Fora, the Law of the Sea Convention. And he says, the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea is a promising instrument through which such action might be taken, given its broad definition of pollution to the marine environment and the dispute resolution mechanisms contained within its provisions.
I'm just confused. We know there's already creeping jurisdiction within the authority of this treaty. We've seen that they claim jurisdiction on land pollution in Great Britain. And we know what happens when we turn authority over to a third party, that what we think is their mission will soon be greatly expanded all over the world to the disadvantage of the United States.
These proliferating bureaus with their thousands of regulations have cost us many of our constitutional safeguards. Whether we believe in our capacity for self-government or whether we abandon the American Revolution and confess that a little intellectual elite in a far distant capital can plan our lives for us better than we can plan them ourselves. And regardless of their sincerity, their humanitarian motives, those who would trade our freedom for security have embarked on this downward course.
Obviously, you're threatening a great deal of sovereignty, and Bilderberg is gloating over that. What tremendous pressure must be involved to make a man alienate his own party more than he already has? The Republican base is already angry about high deficits, stupid spending. Many are opposed to the invasion of Iraq. That's not 100% in the so-called conservative base of the Republican Party. But this will really outrage Republican base when it is forced into the mainstream media, as it will have to be if he succeeds. So obviously Bilderberg considers this a great triumph.
And ask the president not to submit the law of the sea treaty. And if he does, it will diminish whatever he has left of conservative support in this country.
This is the first time now the UN will be able to actually levy a tax. Is that true?
Yeah, what it is the law of the sea treaty, I think, is the greatest single raid on our sovereignty in my lifetime anyway.
It is global socialism. It is world government. It is worse than the United Nations. This International Seabed Authority would have the power over nine-tenths of the world's surface. It would have sovereign control over all the riches at the bottom of the oceans. It would have the power to impose an international tax disguised under the words assessments, fees, and permits.
A little bit of history. About 1982 or 1983, when Bilderberg's junior varsity, as you know as well as I do, the Trilateral Commission is a junior varsity. There's interlocking leadership. Peter Sutherland and Henry Kissinger on the governing boards of both groups. It was created by Rockefeller to include the Japanese and other Asian and Oriental countries. And their meeting involves slightly more than 300 people a year. Triple that of Bilderberg. But they have the common agenda. The Trilateral Commission met in San Diego about 1982 or some such year, a long time ago. Gasoline prices, what was then the all-time high. And the Europeans demanded the United States increase gasoline taxes by 10 cents a gallon. The meeting ended on Monday morning with farewells. On Tuesday morning, the Washington Post had an editorial calling for tax on gasoline to be raised by 10 cents. It passed, Americans paid. And as you know, Washington Post is a stepchild of Bilderberg. The publishers of the Washington Post since late old man Graham bought it in 1948. Have not missed a Bilderberg meeting since 1954 when they first called themselves Bilderberg.